All right, everyone, it's not often that I do like weather alert sort of stuff, but Hurricane Dorian has become so large and powerful at this point and is bearing down on such a critical area of the U.S. that it bears mentioning as a major video. To those of you in the path of this storm, even quite a few hundreds of miles up the coast, now's probably the time to get to higher ground away from the coast. The real problem is that right now Hurricane Dorian is generating a massive storm surge. Some of the pictures and video out of the Bahamas already, it's catastrophic. The Bahamas are largely low-lying, like near sea level, and the storm surge is just inundating everything anywhere near the coast, to the point where some of these, you know, developed areas of the Bahamas, I'm sure in another 24 or so hours when they start clearing things out, will find that there's basically nothing inhabitable left. Like for the most part in the lower-lying coastal areas. I mean, I think the storm surge was measured at over 20 feet in some areas, if I remember correctly. I'm trying to think of a situation in which a 20-foot wall of water is gushing up onto the shore in parts of Florida. I guess the only saving grace is it's missing the even more populated areas to the south, like Miami, but it could change course at any time. Unfortunately, and this is the big thing, it's sort of like a Fukushima thing. Tsunami there, I can't remember how many feet of water it was that wiped Fukushima out. And of course, there are controls in place at most modern nuclear plants generally to prevent this. That was a technical oversight. But there is a 2-reactor nuclear plant right in the path of the hurricane, and it might still be a Cat 5 when it hits that area. Now, hopefully, the storm surges less, and this shoreline reactor doesn't, you know, get flooded and overloaded and, you know, shut itself down, because it's sort of like an anything that can happen does seem to happen with regards to nuclear energy. Sometimes, like, well, all 15 of our control methods just happened not to work that day. Yeah, the rods were positioned wrong, and Joe, the worker, was asleep when he should have been monitoring the temperature in the reactor, and you know, the dude who would normally have been there to press the shutoff valve was out sick, and we couldn't get a replacement. Stuff like that happens an uncanny amount, and it should give people, I think, a little bit of pause. The idea of building nuclear reactors in low-lying coastal areas doesn't really make a lot of sense when you think about it. Unfortunately, that's where a lot of the world's reactors are. That and in places that have a lot of seismic activity. My goodness, humans really are just apes with nuclear weapons, it seems. Also remember, in a pinch, and I'm not officially recommending this because some of you out there, of course, are alcoholics and will use this as an excuse, but Bud Light is pretty close to water. even if beer is a diuretic, in small amounts, I suppose you could probably make do for several days on nothing but light beer. And even if you were getting really thirsty, you'd be drunk, so you'd care less. I'm being tongue-in-cheek, of course, but, you know, sometimes what's happening, I'm sure, all along the coast is the bottled water's gone. It's already been sold. You might be able to just use it, like, you use your faucet, fill up some fucking jugs or something. Barring that, though, there's still plenty of beer. It's mostly water. It's just water that bread walked through. It's happy water is how I've described it before. Again, tongue-in-cheek. Some of the lightest beers are like they're below 4% alcohol. It's like, at that point, is it even really a diuretic? I don't know. Coffee supposedly is too, but trust me, in a situation where the power's out and my home's been flooded and I'm like, well, you know, for the next 12 hours I'm not gonna have much to do other than watch these pretty lights as everything burns around me as the water recedes, yeah, I probably wouldn't care. I'd need some coffee and some beer at that point. Alcoholism, oh my god, who cares? But those of you who are near the coast, I suggest leaving it. It's like after the Chile quake that generated a tsunami there. This was like, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago. I put out a video as quickly as possible saying now is the time to get to high ground. Now is the time to get to high ground, for those of you who are in the path. If you're looking at the pictures and video and stuff from the hurricane hitting the Bahamas, you can imagine how, you know, terrifyingly catastrophic it probably will be in some of these very large urban areas that it's literally going to make landfall on. It's going to be making direct landfall more or less on an area that has several million people living in it. An area that's very low-lying. Like, what's the highest elevation within 10 miles of the coast in some of these locations? It's probably 5 feet or 10 feet or something like that. What's the highest point anyway in southern Florida? There really isn't. It's basically just a gigantic stretch of sandy shoal. So, There's no, I mean, I understand some people down in southern half of Florida, in order to getting to high ground means probably almost leaving your state. But I mean, you're going to have to do something. Get to the highest ground. That hill over there that's 6 feet tall is probably a little bit safer. You know, maybe the upper floors of a concrete structure as opposed to, you know, your shoreline home. One thing is, I'm sure that a little bit of bitterness must seep in. Like, people live in, like, you know, the Sefner trailer parks of Florida and so forth must take a little bit of glee in watching people's, you know, multi-million dollar third homes crash into the waves. I don't, but I'm sure some people do. It's not really a funny topic. The death toll will probably be measurable in Florida, unfortunately. The economic damage will probably be measured in the billions, I would assume. It looks like this might be one of the strongest hurricanes, by the way, that ever sweeps through anything. It was funny, Trump the other day was talking about the issue. At first, people dogpile on climate change. It's like, dude, you're about to witness a bunch of people's homes being destroyed and people dying and stuff. Now's really not the time for good political optics. Unless you're a far leftist not living near the hurricane zone, you probably thought that was a bit crass and a bit, like, lowbrow to do. But then Trump muddles up his words and starts talking about Category 5 hurricanes. Like, wow, I've never seen one before. Well, there have been several strong hurricanes during his presidency, but I think this is arguably like the second or third most powerful hurricane or something like that by wind speed, I think they were measuring. It's right up there with a Katrina or anything. I guess the saving grace is not hitting New Orleans. It's not hitting an area controlled by levees. It's just hitting an area that's kind of used to hurricanes. Like, Florida's the hurricane capital anyway. And the fact that it's flat actually is helpful. This is another thing. I guess this is one saving grace. If a hurricane hits an area with a lot of valleys and mountains or hills or something, the water gets funneled into the lower lying areas, which, by the way, tend to have the highest population concentrations, and it just wipes out everything. If it's a flat area, it causes a lot of flooding, but it doesn't tend to create the sort of torrential runoff and the mass flooding that you would get in the lower-lying areas. Like when a Hurricane Irene swept through here back in, was it 2010 or 11? It's a long time ago. I remember at the time, the first video I ever posted on YouTube that kind of went viral was my Hurricane Irene video at the time. Several tens of thousands of views on that. That was a lot at the time for YouTube and certainly for me as an uploader. And what happened is Irene did incalculable damage. There are parts of Vermont that are still kind of rebuilding now, like Brandon. They've reinforced and shored up everything. They're redoing every sidewalk, it looks like, in the whole fucking place. You couldn't even drive through. It took you half an hour to drive, you know, the 1 mile from one end of Brandon to the other. For several years there, they've been doing massive reconstruction work. They've done a huge amount up there. Part of that is Irene. Irene came along, it wiped out several banks and the banks along the river. I don't mean physical banks like where you get money. Your money stolen from you, rather. They were collapsing, the road was out, bridges got tossed around like they were nothing. And that's because water was being funneled from the mountains to the valleys. Most Vermonters live in valleys. And then people up in the mountain get cut off anyway because the roads have to go over the river sometime, and pretty much all those bridges were gone. Big-ass bridge in Bridgewater got completely wiped out. Somebody had footage of that. It was basically rocking up and down and basically, I guess, floated off down river and got smashed to pieces. In Florida, that sort of thing doesn't happen, but you will see a lot of flooding, huge amounts of shoreline damage. There will be massive power outages. And then you've got this fucking nuclear plant, of, I guess, right in the bullseye of where it's going to make landfall. A situation to monitor, certainly. We don't want another Fukushima. And with that level of storm surge, I mean, it might weaken a little bit before it actually physically makes Floridian landfall, I think, in like 5 or 6 hours. I think it's like 1 p.m. today is when it's expected, I think. You got a few hours, get your Bud Light and batten down the hatches or something. Get to your upper floor, so to speak. If you're anywhere near the coast, you're nuts. You know, there's no other way to put it. If you stack your Lego bricks high enough, you'd be the highest point in Florida, so keep that in mind. That's about all. Peace out.